I am going to discuss in detail about major connectors. Going to the contents, it includes introduction, definition, functions, ideal requirements, types of maxillary major connectors, types of mandibular major connectors, maxillary major connectors in detail, design of maxillary major connectors, factors affecting the selection of the maxillary major connector, mandibular major connectors, design of mandibular major connector, materials used for mandibular and maxillary major connectors, conclusion and references. Introduction. According to McCracken, no component of a removable partial denture should be added arbitrarily or conveniently. Each component should be added for a good reason and to serve a definite purpose. The components of a removable partial denture include major connector, minor connector, rest, direct retainer, indirect retainer, and one or more denture bases. Definition. A major connector is the part of the removable partial denture that joins the components on one side of the arch to those on the opposite side. It is that unit of the partial denture to which all other parts are directly or indirectly attached. Functions of the major connector include unification of the major parts of the processes, distribution of the applied force throughout the arch to selected teeth and tissue, minimization of torque to the teeth, especially the abutment teeth. The principle of leverage is connected with this component part. A rigid major connector will limit movement possibilities by acting as a counteracting lever, and this phenomenon is referred to as cross-arch stability. And the cross-arch stability is used to resist or limit the displacement by functional stresses. Ideal requirements. It should be rigid. It should not impinge on free gingival margins and other soft tissues. The border should be parallel to the mean marginal gingival line, and the gingival margins should be crossed at right angle, and it should not allow foot entrapment. The borders of the maxillary major connector should always cross the palatal midline at 90 degree. Coverage of torus should be avoided. All major connectors should exhibit smooth rounded contours. And when partial denture components must be extended onto the tooth, embrasures may be used to disguise the thickness of the metal framework. In addition, it should provide vertical support for the removable partial denture. It should provide indirect retention. It should enable to place the denture bases when required. It should be comfortable for the patient. It should be made with a material which is biocompatible. Types of maxillary major connectors. It includes 6 types. Single palatal bar, single palatal strap, U-shaped palatal major connector or horseshoe major connector, anterior posterior palatal bar, combination anterior and posterior palatal strap type major connector, palatal plate type major connector or complete palate major connector. Types of mandibular major connectors. It also includes 6 types. Lingual bar, lingual plate, lingual bar with cingulum bar, lingual bar. Factors affecting the selection of the maxillary connector. It mainly includes 7 factors, that is rigidity, presence of palatal torus, requirement of indirect retention, the need for anterior tooth replacement, the need to stabilize weakened teeth, phonetic considerations, and the mental attitude of the patient or patient comfort. A single palatal bar. A palatal connector component of less than 8 mm in width is referred to as a bar. It is a narrow half oval with the thickest point at its center. The bar is generally curved and should not form sharp angles at the junction with denture base. And it is effectively located between the two halves of denture and must be rigid enough to provide support and cross-arch stabilization. And it is often either too thin and flexible or either too bulky. Patient comfort and alteration of palatal contours is highly objectionable and it might cause discomfort to the patient. The decision to use single palatal bar instead of strap should be based on the size of the denture bearing areas that are connected. It is mainly limited to short span class 3 situations and place no teeth anterior to the second premolar position, and its only indication is that it is an interim partial denture until a more definitive treatment can be considered. Disadvantages: it is most difficult for the patient to adjust as to maintain the degree of rigidity. It has to be made bulky. Narrow anterior posterior width with little vertical support from the bony palate and must derive its support by rest on the remaining natural teeth. Single palatal strap, it is the most versatile, therefore most widely used. It consists of a wide band of metal with a thin cross-sectional dimension. It should not be less than 8 mm wide. And the bilateral two support restorations, even those with short edentulous spaces, are more effectively connected. The width increases as the edentulous space increases in length. Bilateral two support restorations, even those with short edentulous spaces, are more effectively connected with a single broad palatal strap connector. A wide palatal strap type may be used for unilateral distal extension situation. If the edentulous area is extensive, bilateral, and is not supported posteriorly to the junction of the hard and soft palate, the connector is modified to complete palate type. Moving to the advantages. As the palatal strap is located in three planes, mainly the horizontal or the vault of the palate, vertical or the lateral slopes of the palate, and sagittal or the anterior slopes of the palate. As it is located in two or more planes, it offers great resistance to bending and twisting forces, and thus it covers large area of palatal tissue, so the stress distribution is good. Force transmitted on different planes are counteracted more easily, and greater rigidity with less bulk, so it provides better patient comfort. Retention is improved by the intimate contact between the metal and soft tissue. Disadvantages: the patient may complain of excessive palatal coverage, and this is mainly due to the improper positioning of the sharp borders. The strap borders should terminate on the posterior slopes of the prominent rugae. And another disadvantage is the adverse soft tissue reaction, which may lead to papillary hyperplasia. This mainly occurs due to the continuous wearing of the cast partial denture for almost 24 hours a day, accompanied with poor oral hygiene. Indications: bilateral edentulous spaces of short span in a tooth support restoration. This is the preferred connector because it may be used for most designs. It distributes masticatory stress over a wide area. It may be made wide or narrow depending on the desired stress distribution. Next is the U-shaped palatal connector. It consists of a thin band of metal running along the lingual surfaces of the remaining teeth and extending onto the palatal tear tissues for 6 to 8 mm. The border should extend 6 mm from the gingival margin, and in some cases it covers the cingula of the present teeth, and the lateral palatal border should be at the junction of the horizontal and vertical slopes of the palate. Indications: it can be used in cases of a large inoperable torae, and when several anterior teeth are to be replaced, the U-shaped or the horseshoe major connectors are used. In cases of palatal patients with exaggerated gag reflex, and when periodontally weakened anterior teeth need some stabilizing support, again the horseshoe major connector is used. Disadvantages: the major disadvantage is the lack of rigidity, that the lateral flexure under occlusal force induce torque or direct lateral force to the abutment teeth, and it has to be bulk to enhance the rigidity, results in increased thickness. It may permit impingement of the underlying tissues when subjected to occlusal loading. The next is the anterior and posterior palatal bar type connectors. The anterior bar is relatively flat. The posterior bar is half oval, similar to the single posterior palatal bar connector, but less bulky. The two bars are joined by flat longitudinal elements on each side of the lateral slopes of the palate. The posterior bar should be located well back in the palate, just anterior to the vibrating line. The two bars lying in different planes produce a structurally strong L-beam effect. Both borders should be gently curved and beveled. Indications: when support is not a major consideration and when the anterior and posterior abutments are widely separated, the anterior and posterior bar connectors may be used, and presence of torus palatinus, that is either undercut or lobulated or too massive, and it may be used as a compromise for the patient. Contraindication: in reduced periodontal support of the remaining teeth, as the main support of this major connector is from the strong abutment teeth, reduced periodontal support of the remaining teeth is adversely affected. Advantages: the main advantage is the rigidity. It follows the L-beam principle, so it is more rigid. And in comparison to the amount of soft tissue coverage, it is by far the most rigid maxillary major connector. Disadvantages: because of the limited palatal tissue contact, little support is derived from the bony palate. It may interfere with the speech, especially the anterior bar. anterior and posterior palatal strap type major connector. Structural is a rigid palatal major connector. Each palatal strap should be flat and has a minimum of 8 mm wide. The strap should be located as far posteriorly as possible to avoid interference with the tongue. The thickness of the metal in the strap should be uniform. The border should be 6 mm away from the pre-gingival margin and should extend onto the lingual surfaces of the teeth. All the borders should be finished in smooth, gentle curves. The open area of the palate, the open areas of the palate till region should be at least 20 × 15 mm. Indications, it include, basically it includes Kennedy's class 1 and class 2 arches. It also include long edentulous spans in class 2 modification 1 arches, class 4 arches, and in cases of inoperable torae also anterior and posterior palatal strap can be used. Disadvantages, even though metal over rugae area may be thinner, it can also cause interference with the frontex. The extensive length of borders may cause annoyance or patient discomfort. The last type of major connector is the palatal plate or complete palate type major connector. The full palate connector is thin, broad, contoured palatal coverage with the natural anatomy of the palate reproduced. The anterior border is 6 mm away from the marginal gingiva and must cover the cingula of the anterior teeth. The posterior border extends to the junction of the soft and hard palate. The material which covers the residual ridges should be one that can be refitted easily. That is basically, it is made up of acrylic resin. The posterior border can be fabricated of either metal or acrylic resin. If this is of metal, the border must be precisely established to induce the soreness, and the metal is difficult to alter satisfactorily. So, if it is of metal, it has to be extended more precisely than acrylic resin, or else it may cause soreness and inflammation. A slight bead should be provided in the metal by lightly scraping the refractory cast prior to forming the wax pattern for the framework. The acrylic resin border is preferred when maximum adhesion and atmospheric seal is needed. Advantages, it is thin and reproduces faithfully the anatomic contours. Its uniform thickness and the thermal conductivity of the metal are readily acceptable to the tongue and underlying tissue. That is, when compared to all other major connectors, the complete palate provides the maximum thermal conductivity of the metal, and it is greatly acceptable by the tongue and underlying tissue as it reproduces the natural contour of the palate. The corrugation in the anatomic replica adds strength to the casting. Thus, a thinner casting with adequate rigidity can be made. Interfacial surface tension between metal and tissues produces the processes with greater retention. Disadvantages include inflammation or hyperplasia and problems with frontex. Indications, they are mainly indicated in class 2 arch with a large posterior modification space. In most situations in which only some or all anterior teeth remain, when the last remaining abutment tooth on either side of the class 1 arch is the canine or first premolar tooth, a complete palate is advised. In the absence of pedunculated torus, again complete palate can be used. Contraindication, when there is a presence of torae which cannot be surgically removed, a full palatal coverage cannot be given. Moving to the design of maxillary major connectors, in 1953, Blatterfein described a systematic approach to designing maxillary major connectors. It includes 5 steps. First one is the outline of primary bearing areas. The primary bearing areas are those that can be covered by denture base. The second step includes the outline of non-bearing areas. The non-bearing areas are the lingual gingival tissues within the 5 to 6 mm of the remaining teeth, the hard areas of the median palatal raphe, including the torae, and the palatal tissues posterior to the vibrating line. And the third step is the outline of connector areas, and the fourth step is the selection of the connector type. That is, the which major connector should be selected. The connectors must have a maximum of rigidity to distribute the stress bilaterally. Connector should be of minimum bulk. When edentulous areas are located anteriorly, the use of only a posterior strap is not recommended. When only posterior edentulous areas are present, the use of only an anterior strap is not recommended.
The need for indirect retention influences the outline of the major connector. And the last step is unification. After selection of the type of major connector, the render base areas and the connectors are joined. So this concludes the maxillary major connectors in detail, the basic types and the design of maxillary major connectors. The mandibular major connectors will be discussed in the next section. Thank you.